Pleasant good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. It is good to see us all this morning in church. I've been asked specifically to welcome two individuals this morning. But I know that, as is customary, welcome will be extended to all other persons at the appropriate time. The host church will do that. This is a Sunday morning. Like all other Sunday mornings, it most significant among all other Sunday mornings. You will understand, therefore, why it gives me such great pleasure to extend a warm welcome to our new priest and his wife, Reverend Father Mike Dafford and Dr. Simone Green Dafford. Reverend Father Green Dafford. That's right, Dr. Simone Green Dafford. This very special welcome is extended on behalf of our two retirees, the Reverend Father Robinson and the Reverend Father Burrington Cannon, both of whom have labored tirelessly among us over these past 2 years. Also, on behalf of the members of the Cure Committee and the committees and members of the 6 congregations within this Gilmore Sanctuary's Cure of Souls, we are extremely happy and grateful that you have accepted our invitation to serve with us in this year. May I assure you that you are committed to the call to intentional discipleship, and in this regard, we pledge to ensure that your sojourn with us will be rewarding, competent, and spiritually fulfilling. And may I add, although the welcome this morning is somewhat brief, it is in no way indicative of the extent of the warmth and sincerity it is welcoming in our midst. We are mindful of the time constraints in which we operate this morning. And we see brothers and sisters, late after this service, our priest and his wife will be leaving for the cathedral to attend the service of ordination. Suffice it to say, however, that we look forward to all of us working together as we continue to build, expand God's kingdom here on earth. There will come a more appropriate time, I'm sure, when you will meet with the various congregations in the kingdom, where we will extend or welcome your own special way. In the meantime, please be assured of our perfect support for you and Mrs. Dafford. We also pray that God will direct and bless your ministry among us, confident in the fact that you have ever called us. We look forward to hearing from you God's message.
Spirit and truth, for the honor and glory of your name. through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You are our sorrow and all desires known, Grant us to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may be made a holy temple acceptable to you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thank you. the earnestness of others. For you know the generous acts of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter, I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your needs. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The gradual hymn number 715. 715.
Let us pray together.
of Mark, chapter 5, Peter, verse 31.
Glory to Christ, our Savior.
When Jesus had crossed again, he goes to the other side. A great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that she may be well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, "If I were to touch his cloak, I will be made well." Immediately, her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned around and said to the crowd, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Lord, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house and said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and waiting loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means "the little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to speak about, she was about 12 years old. At this they were overcome with amazement. It should be ordered to them that no one should know this. And he told them to give her something to eat. The gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ, O Lord.
Thank you.
meditation of our hearts. Be now and always acceptable in your sight as I speak in your name, Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Going on a journey is always fascinating. And I'm sure you all agree, if you go back in your memory and think about the first time you went on any particular journey, I certainly remember a very significant journey in my life. The first time I went to the Blue Mountains with the AYF. We didn't know where we were going. We didn't know what to expect, but we simply followed those who were guiding us. These were the same ones that made us sleep at the riverside. They brought us to an area where power tapped us. We went on a piece of property where we were threatened because we were trespassing. But despite all of that, we went on until we arrived to the pinnacle of that mountain. And it will be something that will always be etched in my mind. Today, we embark on a new journey. And we recognize that there is much excitement, joy, mixed with expectation, anxiety, and even fear. It is a time for you and me to discern God's will for each and every one of us along this uncertain journey. It is a time for us to consider where God is leading us in order that we may make correct and informed decisions. One thing we must be always aware of, especially when embarking on new journeys, is that there will be obstacles. But with God in the midst of our lives, we can overcome these obstacles. This kind of situation where people are embarking on a new journey is similar to what the people of Israel encountered in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verse 1 to 3 and 6 to 10. Let us listen to what it says. This entire commandment that I command you today, you must diligently observe, so that you may live and increase, and go in and occupy the land that the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors. Remember the long way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, in order to humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commandments. He humbled you by letting you go hungry, then by feeding you with manna, with which neither you nor your ancestors were acquainted, in order to make you understand that one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Therefore, keep the commandments of the Lord your God, by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land flowing with streams, with springs, and underground waters welling up in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and honey, of barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, and a land of olive trees and honey, a land where you may eat bread without scarcity, where you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron, and from whose hills you may mine copper. You shall eat your fill and bless the Lord your God for the good land that he Lord had promised a place to the patriarchs Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob centuries earlier. And now, after bringing Israel out of slavery in Egypt, the Lord was about to make good on his promise. Years before all of this, however, Moses had sent a group of men into the land to find out what the land had to offer. They returned with a large cluster of grapes from the valley of Eshkol. As an example of the bounty they found there, they told Moses, "We came to the land to which you sent us. It flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruits." But then they continued, "However, the people who dwell in the land are strong. All the people we saw in it are of great height, and we seem to ourselves like grasshoppers." In this report from these men to Moses, it really meant that their conclusion in the end was simply negative. They saw these people of great stature, and having seen them, their own trust in God waned. This was lack of faith in God's promises, and consequently, Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. But this type of behavior was not new, for they often lacked faith and trust in God. Listen to what they said to Moses at one point. "Oh Moses, why have you brought us out here in the wilderness to die? We have nothing to eat or drink here. We like the food so much better back in Egypt." After all that God had done for them, taking them out of bondage, saving them from the pursuing Egyptians, bringing them safely to Sinai, supplying them with manna, quail, and water from the rock, they kept on complaining. In spite of all of this, Moses interceded for them, and the Lord forgave their sins, providing means of atonement and forgiveness for them at the tabernacle. God could have destroyed these ungrateful people, but instead, he brought them to the promised land. What a mighty God we serve. As we are gathered here today to embark on a new journey and to give God thanks for what we have received from his bounty, let us explore three concepts that we learned from this reading from Deuteronomy chapter 8. The first concept is that of humility. To be humble means to be meek, modest, not overly being proud. And if we want an example of humility from the Bible, you can simply turn to Psalm 131, which tells us, "Lord, my heart is not haughty, nor mine eyes lofty. Neither do I exercise myself in great matters or in things too high for me. Surely I have behaved and quiet myself. As a child that is weaned of his mother, my soul is even as a weaned child. Let Israel hope in the Lord from henceforth and forever." This is a psalm that we had to know while at UTC. A psalm that I still call upon to remind me that if I am too high, that the Lord needs to bring me down. The Israelites had forgotten that God had delivered them. They had forgotten the great works of God and demanded more from God. They were very haughty, and as a result, they went around in circles for 40 years. And if there was a map that I could show you of the 40 years in the wilderness, you will see that they literally went in circles for 40 years. They did all of that we got to the promised land. But as humans, we must recognize that pride is a part of our people. And so sometimes it's difficult for us to trample on our pride and be brought low. Would one suppose that such a people, after their slavery, should need the thorns of the wilderness to humble them? But we, even us here in this country, who after 400 years of slavery, are still unable to be humbled before God. It seems as if we are walking in the footsteps of the Israelites. But my friends, I say to us this morning, in order for us to be humble, we must recognize our insignificance. And like other people under the direction of God, we must recognize that none of us are greater than the other. The people of Israel needed to understand and attain humility before embarking on the journey to the promised land. They had to know God and be open to God's will before entering that promised land. And so we too are called to be humble before we embark on this new journey. We too are called to recognize God's voice, to humble ourselves before God before we undertake this new journey. The world in which we live does not promote humility, but as a church, as a community of faith, we must demonstrate humility for those who are around us to see. Being humble is not about being trampled on or about not being assertive, but it is simply about living a Jesus-shaped life without a fanfare and a hype. If we are going to live together as the community of God, we need not to just speak about God, but live a godly life which comes through humility. We need to be willing to roll up our sleeves and do the work that God has given us to do. Complaining about the challenges will not help. Cursing God will not help. But seeing God's plan and discerning our roles in the scheme of things will help us to get from point A to point B. The Israelites had to learn that the hard way. And many of us in our lives can attest to learning lessons the hard way. But let us remember that as the body of Christ, we must put the right foot forward. For pride destroys. And we must remember that in the grand scheme of God's plan, it is not about an individual, but it's about the whole body of Christ, which is Christ's church. The next concept we must recognize and accept is that God is our sustainer. God sustained Israel while they were in Egypt. He sustained them in the wilderness, and He continued to sustain them even in the promised land. We as humans are totally dependent on God's grace for sustenance. Wisdom 11 verse 21 to 26 tells us, "For you love all things that exist, and detest none of the things that you have made. For God would not have made anything if He had hated it. How would anything have endured if you had not willed it? Or how would anything not come forth by you have been preserved? You spare all things, for they are yours, O Lord, you who love the living." This was the experience of the people of Israel. They experienced a God who kept all things in balance. The one who created, provided, and continued to hold all things together. The sustaining power of God is what keeps the earth in place. It is what keeps us alive. It is so awesome that it preserves the souls of the dead, and it helps us to see God for who God is. But just as the complaining Israelites, we oftentimes forget this reality, and we only want to believe that we can sustain our own selves. And so many times when you watch the television, you hear talk show hosts and some persons who consider themselves as inspiration to others, telling them that you don't have to worry about any external need. You can find the strength within yourselves. You can do whatever you want by your own accord. And you hear many speeches speaking about inner strength and speaking about relying totally on self. This, however, friends, is not sensible, as we must remember that we are nothing without God. I am nothing without God. You are nothing without God. This is something we must always bear in mind. Moses reminds the people that one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. If we go back to Genesis in the first chapter, we see where it speaks about the wind of God over the face of the earth, and we see where God blew breath into humans. This is representing the sustaining and life-giving power of God. Our sustenance comes from God, and the word of God is on what we must feed. So when we speak of being sustained by God, we recognize that God is creator and sustainer, and God has left his word as a part of that sustenance. So God sustains us through his own power and through the word, so that we can feed on this word and gain even more sustenance from it. Moses linked God's commandments to God's sustaining power, pointing to the fact that the word of God gives life. And this is why, friends, one of the tenets of Anglicanism is scripture. For we must